say thanks enough for all that God has done, is doing, and has promised for us. We can begin by giving him thanks and praise in song. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Hallelujah. We begin this morning with hymn number 73. Thanks from hearts full of gratitude as we count our blessings and we realize just how good, how great, how merciful you are. Bless us with your presence. Bless us through your word. We pray in Jesus' name. If you're up to it, I invite you to stand as we sing just before the message, 125.
Lord, now I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. It was July 10, 1941. The place was Jedwabne in Poland, a town of 6,000. 3,000 Polish Jews, 3,000 Polish Catholics lived in this town. They were neighbors, friends, co-workers, classmates. For generations, they had lived together in this small town. But shortly after the Nazi occupation began, the Gestapo held a town hall meeting in Jedwabne. And they told the town authorities that there would be no repercussions, no consequences, if anyone in their town decided to kill their Jewish neighbors. There were no orders, no instructions to kill, simply that there would be no consequences if they did, except that they were welcome to help themselves to their Jewish neighbors' property and possessions. The next day, 40 Catholics somehow forced around 40 Jewish men into an old barn to dig a very large pit in the barn floor. There they slaughtered their neighbors and threw them into the pit. Then they gathered the Jewish women and children into that same barn and set it on fire. Over 300 Jews died that day at the hands of their friends and neighbors. How do we explain such horror, such a tragedy? It seems so incomprehensible, so unbelievable that neighbors could do this to one another. Today we want to explore the idea of evil in our world, or what some theologians might call depravity. Is evil a real thing, or do we just call anything we don't like evil? This word depravity can be defined as the corruption of human nature that we're all born with. And our church, for one, believes that this evil is very real. How bad is it? Well, our church believes that the human race is totally depraved. In other words, there are no exceptions. Everyone, born on planet Earth is depraved. I know there are others who believe that mankind is basically good, and that if everyone just had the same access to education, justice, and opportunities in life, that mankind would do the right thing and prosper and live together in perfect harmony. I was watching an episode of The Waltons on TV last week. And in this episode, a young soldier was sharing with John Walton a letter he had received from his Jewish grandfather, who was living back in the old country during the Second World War. And he said, Grandpa had heard rumors that internment camps were being set up in his country. John pondered that for a moment. And he said, son, I don't want to disagree with you, but I think your grandfather has heard wrong. I mean, come on, think about it. In our day and age, we have become so civilized. One group of civilized people would not do this to another. Now, I note that this is, we're not talking, Grandpa was not talking about internment camps. Internment camps are camps where you keep prisoners of war or political prisoners. Or, as in the case of Canada, we locked away German and Japanese citizens of Canada because we were afraid of them during the war. That's internment. Grandpa was talking about internment. To inter means to bury. It's places where you take people by the thousands to slaughter and bury them. And John Walton was sure that in our day, such a thing could never happen. And the young soldier said, yes, I hear what you're saying. But didn't we also say another world war would never happen? I wonder, what would happen in Canada if suddenly, for some reason, murder was decriminalized? If suddenly there was no consequences, no repercussions to murder, what would happen to Canada? I don't even want to ponder. What makes us think that evil is a real thing? Watching the news. Remember in 1994, in Rwanda, how 800,000 Tutsis were hacked to death with machetes by their Hutu neighbors and friends? Remember the genocide of Armenian Christians by Turkish Muslims? And more recently, the death of more than 100,000 Christians in South Sudan by the Muslim government in Khartoum? And how about it, that lady, Susan Smith, in 1994? Do you remember the story? How she drowned her own children? Claimed that they had been kidnapped because her boyfriend didn't want to raise someone else's children, and she was afraid she might lose her boyfriend over that, and so she murdered her own small children. Is evil a real thing? In sixth grade, I was walking across the schoolyard alone during recess when I heard myself say a swear word under my breath for no apparent reason. I'm not even sure where I ever heard that word before. But I was shocked. I was stunned. That's the day I realized that there was evil in me as there was in everyone else. And I began to wonder, to search, how I could get rid of it. How pervasive is evil? All we have to do is look around. Suicide bombings continue in so many places. An incomprehensible torture and rape of prisoners is so widespread these days. That mankind was created good. And yet by chapter 4 of Genesis, Cain was beating his brother to death in anger and jealousy. And what was the issue? Religion. By the time we get to Genesis 6, the Bible says, "And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagining of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." Do you hear that? Only evil continually. And I don't have to remind you of King Herod's slaughter of the baby boys in Bethlehem. Evil's been around a long time. In every town, every country, every tribe. Evil is a real thing. Where did it come from? We humans are born with evil in our hearts. It's not that people are entirely bad. There's some good in every one of us. There's some of the image of God remaining in each one. But we are all fallen in every aspect of our lives. We were created in the very image of the Holy God. But we were born fallen, corrupted, sinful. So by the time of Noah in Genesis 8, the Bible says the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. The prophet Jeremiah says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. The New Testament agrees, Romans 3, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that seeketh after God. There is none that doeth good, no, not one, who doesn't have God in their hearts and lives. Who's to blame for all this evil in our world? Should we blame Adam and Eve? After all, that's what they did. Adam blamed Eve, Eve blamed the serpent. Should we blame the devil? Or should we blame God? Maybe we should blame Noah. I mean, God wiped the world clean. He emptied the world because of the wickedness of mankind, save for one righteous family. So after the flood, we started afresh with one righteous family. So it's going to be paradise, right? Didn't last long, did it? Because every one of us is capable of evil until we surrender our lives to Jesus. We are all fallen. All have sinful natures that we can't control. That's why we all must make Jesus not just our Savior, but our Lord, our Master. Why does God allow evil in our world? Why does God not step in and stop it? Because there are thousands of Christians dying every year under Islamic persecution in the Middle East, North Africa, Indonesia, Egypt, Iran, China, and many other places. Why doesn't God stop it? For the Bible tells us that our God is holy and righteous and just. So we know God does not like evil. The Bible also tells us that God is sovereign and almighty. So we know God is capable of preventing evil. So God could intervene and stop the drunk driver before he crashes into a busload of teens. God could intervene and stop a dad on drugs from beating his wife and kids. God could stop terrorists from flying airplanes into tall buildings. He could intervene and stop vehicles from driving up onto sidewalks to kill pedestrians. So why doesn't he? He probably does much more than we are aware of. But if God struck down everyone who did evil in our world, there would be no one left. There would be no one for God to love. No one for God to redeem. No one for him to welcome into heaven. For all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. If God stepped in and stopped every act of evil, there would be no more free will. We'd be reduced to robots and puppets. We could not love, nor be loved. God created us for love. So instead of canceling evil, God promised to turn evil things into something beautiful. Into something good. Turn it into a blessing. God uses the things we see as evil in our world to bless us and to build his kingdom, bringing good out of tragedies. God continues every day to turn evil into blessings for his children. No evil deed is wasted, but is used for some good for those who claim the name of Jesus and walk by faith. So how do you and I deal with all this evil in our world? How do we get rid of it? We'll never get rid of the evil till Jesus comes back. In the meantime, Christians around the globe are affected by evil, just like everyone else. Probably even more. We seem to be a favorite target of the evil one. The Bible says in Romans 12, "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto God's wrath." Likewise, in Exodus 14, he says, "The Lord shall fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." We are prone to react to evil, to fight back, to demand our rights. But God says, no, that's not my way. I will fight for you. You bless those. You love those. You do good to those who harm you, who cause evil in our world. Ephesians 6 says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." So, when you get frustrated by evil in our world, don't take it out on people. People are not our enemies. The cause is much deeper than that. David says in Psalm 27, "Though an army should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, even in this will I be confident. For in the time of trouble, God shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret places of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set my feet upon a rock. Therefore, verse 14 says, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Again, in Psalm 23, David says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. 1 John 4. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Who's the them? In the previous three verses, John was talking about those who exhibit the spirit of the Antichrist. Those who cause evil in our world. You have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen? This is where our confidence comes from. He who is in us, he who watches over us, neither slumbers nor sleeps. He has our back. He always finds a way to bring good out of the bad. And he holds us in the palm of his hand. Dealing with evil in our world, God says, you leave that to me. More important question is, how do we deal with the evil within us? That's the more critical question. How do we get rid of the evil we were born with? The Bible gives us an answer. Step one, acknowledge it. Admit it. Number two, ask God to cleanse our hearts from all impurities, all the sinful desires, the sinful attitudes, our sinful ways. And then three, God gives us a new heart, a new nature, as white as snow. You know, everything we surrender to the Lord, he purifies, he makes holy. We give him the garbage, and he makes something beautiful out of it. We give him the pain, the hurts, the depravity. And he turns it into something wonderful, holy. He replaces the evil we were born with goodness, love, and joy, and peace, and faith, and gentleness, and patience, and self-control. Evil does not stand a chance when we open it up to God. It's only when we cover it up, try to cover it up, that the evil in us becomes a problem. But if we open it up to the Son, he purifies. Evil doesn't stand a chance when we give it to God. It's only a problem when we try to deal with it ourselves, when we try to overcome it ourselves. Give it to Jesus. There's victory in Jesus, who is our rock, our shield, our deliverer. As for the evil in our world, friends, it's not a surprise. God promised us it would get worse before it got better. He also promised us that he would give us victory. That he could make us overcomers of the evil in the world around us. that he would give us peace in the midst of turmoil. So he doesn't want us to lose any sleep over evil that is breaking out around the globe. Neither does he want us to fret and worry about the evil we see in ourselves. He's made a way. He has a plan. And he's laid it out for us in the New Testament. If we will confess it and give it to him, he will cleanse. He will wash it away. He will give us victory. Don't try to deal with it yourself. Give it to God. He's the Almighty. Would you pray with me? Lord in heaven above, we can't imagine what you see when you look down upon our planet. All the fighting, corruption, crime. Father, forgive us. You created us good. But we have been corrupted, every one of us. And we need a Savior. We admit, Lord, that we can't rescue ourselves. We give our sins to you. We give our guilt to you. We accept you as our Savior. And ask, Lord, that you would live in us. That you would be our hope and our salvation. We pray that you would help us to live a new life in Christ Jesus. As for the evil in the world around us, Lord, help us to be a light. Help us to be an influence for good. Help us to spread your grace, your love, your peace wherever we are. We don't want to be part of the problem, but we want to be channels for your goodness, for your justice, for your hope. In a world that is getting darker, help us, Lord, to shine brighter as we surrender our lives more and more to you, as we listen ever more closely to the voice of your Spirit. Lord, lead us, keep us, and use us. In Jesus' name we pray. We conclude with hymn number 441, Love Lifted Me. When nothing else would help, God in his love came to us. In love, Christ died for us. In love, the Good Shepherd pursued us. Lifted us up out of deep miry clay. Gave us a new life. A new life in Christ. Praise God for his wonderful love.
sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I'll cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true, merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows his will obey. He, your savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me.
For those watching at home today, thank you for joining us. I pray that you will know the victory of Jesus in your life this week, and the blessing of God Almighty. Now, unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory.